Black Swamp Radio, the only paranormal radio station with a frog in a blender.
There's a touch of madness around here.
From a dark, damp, stench-infested laboratory that smells from the decomposing bodies of tweakers and crackheads that were used during the experimentation for alien research. In an old, ghostly haunted abandoned dwelling with ghosts and specters of all ages, somewhere in the alien-infested Black Swamp of Northwest Ohio, this is Black Swamp Radio Live, and I am your host, Arizona Tramp. Welcome to the show, guys. We've got a great show for you tonight. It's great to be back. You're going to like this one. But first, I got to tell you a few things, all right? So we're going to start off with the Paranormal Radio app. You can find our station, Black Swamp Radio, at the Paranormal Radio app if you go to TalkStream Live and you download the apps. It's simple as that. Or you can get the app from Google Play. I think that's awesome. We also have our listening line, which is 701-801-4735. That's thanks to TalkStream Live, too. And I got to give Angel and PSN Radio Network a shout out. All right. And as of this week, we are on FM 94.3. All right. Well, we've got our listener stories. If you have a story, you don't want to come on the air and tell it, that's just fine. All you need to do is go to our Facebook page and send it to me through our, you know, just type it out, send it to me through Facebook page, and I'll have it read over the air. You don't have to give your real name or anything. It can be UFO stories, ghost stories, cryptid stories, whatever you want to tell us. Or you can come on the air and you can tell me all about it. All right? The last thing I want to mention is that our show tonight is brought to you by the Outer Limits magazine and our affiliates, which if you go to the Black Swamp Radio main page and you scroll down all the way, then what you can do is you can click on the affiliates link and it will take you to a link to get your very own Shoutcast server for a very good price. I'm telling you, it's a super good price. You don't have to pay $50 a month for a Shoutcast server. You don't have to pay $25 a month for a Shoutcast server. You don't have to pay $15 a month for a Shoutcast server. Okay? You don't even have to pay $10. So you click on this link and you go get your Shoutcast server and you're all set to start your own little deal there. With that being said, all right, guys, it's time that I bring out my first guest. And who I have with me is the lead investigator for Haunted Toledo. But that's not all that she does. You're going to like this. I have Sarah Chelten with me. And she is a published author. And she is lead investigator for Haunted Toledo. Hello, Sarah, and welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Well, thanks for being here. We've been talking about this for days, and then all of a sudden you decide, okay, well, I'll do it at this time. And it's like, okay, we'll do it. And so you're the lead investigator of Haunted Toledo, and what all does that entail? And I know there's a little bit more to it than that, so go ahead and tell me.
Well, I am the lead investigator for Haunted Toledo, and that just means that I direct where the crew is going to go in certain buildings. I direct where the research is going for the history of whatever establishment that we're doing. And I am also the public relations manager, which means that anything that has to do with dealing with the public or booking events or anything like that, that's what I run. That's my job.
So, with Haunted Toledo, what is your radius, by the way? How far out do you go?
Well, we started local, just the Toledo area with our fan base, and we kind of expand all over the United States now.
All over the United States. How far out have you been?
Well, fan base, we're all over the place.
Right.
But where we are going in 2018, I have some interesting places that I can't exactly talk about right now that we have booked, but they're outside of Ohio area.
Wow. All the way out. You guys are starting to grow, I guess. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, it just kind of exploded overnight.
Okay, well, we can come back to Haunted Toledo at the end of this. And I'll be asking you about a scary story or something that Tim had not, Chris had not told us all about. But, I'm more interested right now in the fact that you are a published author. You write children's books. You wrote a children's book and you wrote a different book. I don't quite remember what that was. And
yes.
What you do with those books is what really intrigued me.
Well, as you said, I write children's book. It's The Germophobic Tooth Fairy is my children's book. And it's a kind of silly, on the line of Dr. Seuss type of deal.
Cool.
It's basically a young tooth fairy in training to collect teeth. But he's a germaphobe. And he comes across a young boy who hasn't brushed his teeth, and he goes on strike. So it's just kind of silly and fun. And I visit hospice and hospitals in whatever area I happen to be in at the time, dressed as a fairy, and I go and read my book for free for the kids that in the hospital.
That's absolutely awesome. What was the other book?
The other book is The Diary of an Extraordinary Child, and that's in editing right now, getting ready to go on the bookshelf. And that is about a teenage girl doing her best to live a normal life despite her cancer.
And when will that be out?
That is going to be out in the fall of 2018.
Okay, so you go to the hospice and you go to the hospitals. You said something about how you visit the cancer patients and read your book.
Yes.
And the question about the book, is it kind of like Sheldon Cooper sticking his hands inside somebody's mouth?
Right. It's basically along that kind of thing. The tooth fairy is very scared of germs and very upset that this boy hasn't brushed his teeth, so upset that he accidentally wakes up the child, and they get into kind of a bit of an argument over brushing teeth. And in the end of it, he has to learn how to deal with the germs. And the children have to learn with brushing their teeth.
So if someone wants to go ahead and read their stuff at a hospital or hospice, is it very difficult to get started doing that?
Well, there's different things you have to do. Like, you have to do a background check. You have to be a published author. You have to have a kind of tough skin. It's really difficult sometimes to sit there and read a book to a child that is currently receiving chemotherapy in front of you, and you're doing your best to make them smile. It's something great to do, but it does affect you.
Yeah, I imagine it does, but giving back is what makes it all worthwhile.
Right.
I got the ultimate respect for you right now. That's just so freaking cool.
No, thank you.
You know, and for people who don't know, she's a very sweet, nice lady. I've been talking to her for a few days. I got the chance to meet her at the Collingwood Arts Center when I met 222 Paranormal and everybody at Haunted Toledo and all that. And so, but I didn't get that much of a chance to talk to them, but, you know, it's like, it's cool. I'm glad I got the opportunity to do this now with you.
So, yes, it's a pleasure.
You have something else that's also passionate for you right now, and this has to do with Haunted Toledo as well, and it has to do with there's an old hospital that was built in the 1800s on the north end of Toledo they're talking about tearing down.
Right.
So talk to us about that, and we can get this petition running.
Well, the big thing about Haunted Toledo, first of all, is that we do tell a good ghost story. We do investigate the ghost, but what we mainly do is the history end of it.
Right.
That's how we come in. That's our goal, is tell the history so that we can preserve it, because so many things are being knocked down that have these legends and these amazing structures inside, and they're not being preserved. And so our main goal is to preserve history by telling the legends and the folklore. It's a way to get the youth involved also, because let's face it, once we are gone, we have to rely on them to keep history alive.
Yeah.
And if we can't get them interested, then there's no hope.
So what we do is we
go in and we talk to these kids. We just did a school not long ago at the Maritime Academy in Toledo, and we talk about the history first, and we talk about the research, and then we hit them with the legend, who died there, what is the ghost story there, and suddenly they're interested. Suddenly they're going home and talking to their families about it. So that's why we do what we do with both the history and the ghost end of it. And Riverside is in danger right now of being torn down. And like you said, it was built in the late 1800s. A lot of good stories. Can you even imagine of who was born here, who had died there, the people that came in and out of there. So many wonderful stories, so many wonderful memories. And it's about to be torn down, and it's just a shame. And I have no illusions thinking that we're going to be able to save the building itself. I understand TPS wants to progress. They want a different structure or a parking lot. Lord knows we need more of those. But what we do want to do is go in there, document and film each room, each hallway, really dig into the research, really find out who was born there, who passed away there, listen to the stories. We hear so far some stories of a nurse that used to work there that roams the hallways. We really want to investigate that. Yeah, yeah. And these are just things that we owe to the community. I mean, TPS may own this building, but they purchased it with taxpayer money.
Right.
And they are tearing it down with taxpayer money. This belongs to the community, and the community wants these stories to be preserved.
I like the way you guys think. I was in the ER there a couple times in the 80s, and it was a cool hospital. When I was there in the 80s, before I was really into anything that I'm into nowadays, it always had a mystical weird feeling when I'd walk into that or walk near that place. I didn't know it was built in the 1800s. And so can you give us a couple examples of stories about this hospital?
Well, the stories so far that I'm hearing are of this nurse, that she's in the hallways and sometimes in the room. I'm not sure of her name yet. I'm still really digging into these stories, still asking the community that has seen or heard of this story to come forward. We would love to hear the community's stories on this or any other stories they have. It's kind of fuzzy at this time.
Okay.
And we're just kind of rushing to get these stories because it's now being torn down.
Right.
And actually, TPS voted, the board, they voted who to bring in, and we got the unanimous vote that they want us to come in and document. And the administration voted, and we got that unanimous vote. However, the problem came up that another team out somewhere in Toledo called up complaining that Haunted Toledo was allowed to come in and nobody else was allowed to come in. And apparently,
I have an idea who that was, too.
I'm sure you do.
Yeah. I shouldn't mention any names, but...
No, we won't mention names, but...
No.
It was kind of ridiculous. He made a big deal about it, and it kind of put the brakes on, and then they started asking themselves, you know, we're going to have all these ghost hunters wanting to come in. Who should be the right person to do it? So they voted again, and
they feel liable too if the floor should cave, you know, if you should drop through the floor or something fall on you. They're afraid
that
you can sue them. It's all about money, and you got to go about the
right
money. And you know, the thing that pisses me off most is that they let buildings like this decay, and they do it on purpose. It's like Cardi Finkbeiner told me in the mid 80s where the sports arena was going to be. They have plans that go spread decades about what they want to do with things. And you're not going to interfere with it. So
right. This
is really going to have to be something that the public has to step up for, or it's...
Well, it couldn't be that bad off since the board has their offices in the Riverside.
Well,
so
the one side of...
I'm assuming that it's not so bad.
The one side of Riverside, the front end where the ER used to be. Not the ER, excuse me. But the very front end towards downtown, that they used for doctor's offices and stuff like that after the hospital closed. And that was maintained. So it's not that bad. It's the backside of the hospital they let go to hell.
Right.
There's a video of, I forget the couple, who are in Ohio, and they crawl into all these places. And they have video that it's like 30-minute video of them walking through the back end of they went in illegally, and they walked through the window, and they took video of the place, and they showed the morgue, and they showed all this kind of stuff that's all in decay.
Right.
And it was pretty sad why they would allow this kind of thing to take place, especially with a building that should be protected by the historical society. You would think that would have been protected by that.
I agree. I'm actually quite upset and heartbroken that the Historical Society has not stepped up. But going back to the decay of the building and the concerns there with liability, we did offer to sign any type of waiver that we need to. This is what my team does. We go into condemned buildings. We know what to do because we actually have a man that has run his own construction company on our team. So he goes in and he lets us know where to stay, where we can walk. We caution tape off places we can't go. We know what we're doing. We're very professional about it. And signing waivers is no problem. You know, we actually went into the Commodore. Gorgeous,
yeah.
Gorgeous. I mean, I couldn't believe Arizona. You go into this, you step off of this elevator and you walk down this hallway, and I swear to you, it is like walking into a time capsule.
Wow.
I mean, it is incredible. I have photos I need to show you of this place, but you can just, you go in and it's very dark and your flashlights are just kind of skimming the room, and you're seeing this huge mural, and it's faded and it's kind of peeling and everything, but it's still in such good condition. And another room with these huge chandeliers. And you can just imagine the life that it once had. You can practically hear the music playing as you're walking through because the memories are so thick in there.
Yeah, back in the 90s too, but in the 80s, I got myself... I can say it now because I'm not going to get in trouble for it now, but the door and the windows were sort of open on the Pythian Castle. And for anybody that doesn't know what the Pythian Castle was, it was created in the 1800s, and it was a four or five story. I don't remember if it's four or five stories, but it had two theaters in it. And the very top floor was where the actresses and all those people hung out. And then there was the restaurant that was on the second floor. And the first floor was, it was a lodge. And then it turned into, make a long story short, it turned into a music school in the 70s. And some hippie caught it on fire. And then it caught on fire for a second time after... the music school closed, and there was a little bit of shops in it, but then it caught fire again, and it's in the shape that it's in now. But before somebody, a private owner, bought the Pythian Castle, you could go up there, and you could see it was gorgeous. The theater was, it had all the woodwork. It still had the plaster carvings. And but you had to be super careful, or you were going to drop right through that floor because there was no roof on it. There was even a stove, an old gas stove that was probably 30 feet long for the restaurant. And there was no way to get that out of there, and that was worth money. That was worth big money. Now it's just a shell, and I guess somebody else has bought it. And they're going to rebuild it. But I don't understand why they're going to put the effort back into the Pythian Castle, but they don't put the effort into Riverside Hospital, since Riverside Hospital is not going to cost nearly as much money to fix, because there's part of it that, you know, doesn't need as much work.
Correct. Yeah, so. It's a shame. And it's very interesting that TPS just had a tax levy passed. But I don't believe that they let people know just how much money it's going to cost just to tear down this building, and then whether they rebuild some offices there or they make it into a parking lot and have to pave it all over again, it's going to cost more money. So yeah. Either way they're looking, it's going to cost money.
Yeah, they bought
the
building.
You know, TPS is on the business of education.
Yeah.
History is part of education.
Yeah, well, not these days. They like to tear monuments down and things like that so people will forget. But it all goes back to, like, when the old mayor, Cardi Finkbeiner, in the 80s told me that they had plans of putting the sports arena downtown, and that the vote was unofficial then. It was only a stipulation. They were going to do what they wanted to do. And if you remember, we voted to keep the sports arena on the east side just where it was. And they didn't listen, and they tore it down anyway. And that's one reason why I don't any longer vote for the city of Toledo.
Right.
I don't live there anymore. But, you know, that was proof for me that what we want doesn't matter. But that's
my
opinion.
Well, that was clearly said to me on the 7th. I met with the TPS board president, and she assured me over and over again that Haunted Toledo will be getting in the building this month to fully document it, do everything we need to do so it can go in the books, so it can go in the film docuseries. When all was said and done, 2 days later, I'm getting the runaround from Mr. Gantz, who she kind of put charge.
When is the demolition scheduled to start happening?
Well, Mr. Gantz keeps on trying to assure me that nothing is going to begin until late spring, early summer. But we have people that want to remain anonymous here, that the backhoes and everything have already gotten on property and they're already ripping things out. So their promise of that they won't touch any, and assuring me that we're going to get in before anything happens, it's just kind of a line, I think. I think it's just trying to push us off right now. And they don't realize that history is not just important to Haunted Toledo. History is important to the community.
Well, here's an idea, and I already mentioned it to Chris. If you know someone who has a drone that's wired for sound and video, then there's open windows all over that place. If you know somebody who really knows how to operate a drone, go in there with the drone. You might even pick up an EVP, or you might be able to see something with the video, And that is a legal way to get around them telling you no.
Right. Well, we are actually speaking to an attorney right now. We also have a couple of council people that are on our side to preserve the history and trying to come up with ways on how we can get around this red tape right now, this now that they're saying it's a safety issue. We'll see what happens. If the last resort is we're going to end up doing a protest. We are going to stand there.
Where can we find this petition?
You can find the petition on the Haunted Toledo's Facebook page, or you can find it on my page, which is the Sarah Chelten page. Okay. It's free to sign. It takes 10 seconds to sign it. There is a pop-up from the petition site itself asking to donate to their website. That has right. nothing to do with us. You can just click skip or close on that. We're not asking for money.
Well, that's always a good thing when you don't ask for money.
Right. No, and we're not charging TPS or the community, the city, anybody for us to document this. We are going in at our own risk with our own time, and we are going to document this building for the book by Arcadia Publishing. Christopher Tillman is the author, and for our docuseries.
Very cool. Back onto Haunted Toledo. So you went to the Commodore Perry, and Chris was telling me a little bit. I mean, yeah, Chris was telling me a little bit about it.
You have to be careful with Chris telling.
Do you? Okay. Well, you could tell us about the Commodore Perry and a couple other things if you have the time.
Well, I have the time, and I need to set the record straight because okay. Christopher Tillman is the biggest skeptic that is alive.
Is the what?
And
the biggest.
He
what?
Is the biggest skeptic.
Oh yeah.
He has no belief that you can get three solid pieces of evidence, three solid pieces, and he will still doubt it and still wonder. And that's just, God bless him, that's just his character. That's just him.
Yeah,
and
we have an issue between
me
and Chris about orbs. And yeah, definitely orbs can be dust. But when you take one picture and the orb's there, and you take the next picture and the orb's not there, and you can clearly see a face in the orb. There is this church out before, it was in between Sandusky and Cleveland. I forget exactly what town it was in. This guy bought this church. They used this church during World War I for the medical to bring people in because hospitals were completely filled. You know, because World War I ended because everybody got sick. There was nobody left to fight the war. There was a plague going along, and I don't remember what people came down with. But anyway, throughout this entire church, especially when you went into where they kept the people inside the church part itself, you could take, and it wasn't dusty, I can verify that, you could take multiple pictures, and there was hundreds of orbs in there. And every time you would take a picture, the orbs would move, and dust doesn't move upwards.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and dust doesn't move side to side unless it's windy. Well, we did this time of year, and all the windows, well, you can't even open the windows inside the church part anyway. So there was no airflow. I mean, so take that, Chris.
Yes. I don't share his disdain for orbs as strongly. I do believe a lot of what people take are dust. But when you can see them moving with a purpose, you can clearly see it coming out of someplace and literally stop and then change direction, I can't say that's not an orb. It has to be.
Yeah, I
agree. Dust doesn't move that way.
I agree with that. Simply, orbs are, me and Chris agree with the fact that orbs are not proof per se by itself. But when you see that orb, it tells you, yes, let's do something here. There's something
right.
here that we need to look at. That's what
right.
the orb tells me. It basically tells me, is this a waste of time or not? You know, when you take a picture and you got 500 orbs inside of a big room like that. It's like, okay,
right.
Let's see what we can get. You know, because some of it's right. dust and some of it isn't.
And then when you get an EVP at the same time you get that orb, mm-hmm. to me, that's solid evidence.
That yeah, because you've got several different pieces of evidence. So anyway,
correct.
We got distracted with the orbs. Let's go back to the Commodore Perry there.
Well, the Commodore Perry was a very interesting building. As I said, it had so much history to it, and that just gives me goosebumps on its own. Just walking, it's like walking onto the Titanic. It's incredible. If you ever have the opportunity to legally be allowed to go in there, do it. It's amazing. It's breathtaking. I'm actually taking Mayor Paula Hicks Hudson for an interview through Commodore Perry very soon, and we're so excited about that. Just kind of getting her take on what Toledo's history means to her, and then us showing her why it's important to preserve it. Just really, until you put it in front of somebody's face and take their breath away, they don't get it yet.
Right.
You know, once it's in front of them, they understand. You know, but we went into this Commodore Perry, and it was an incredible night. As soon as we start setting up, they heard piano music, which is one of the stories that is told at Commodore Perry, that you hear a piano playing. There used to be a piano there, but it is no longer there. So, for some reason, this music continues to play. Now, of course, as Christopher Tillman told you, that we were in the process of setting up, so we didn't even get to catch that yet.
Right.
But we did see some very interesting things. We saw, I was sitting in the ballroom by myself, and I kept looking in this doorway, and I kept seeing this shadow figure kind of peeking around the door frame or the doorway and kind of watching me and then going back and then peeking and watching. And as I followed it, other people on the team pretty much see what I'm doing, and they come out and they follow me. And we're walking around. We're asking questions. And my camera guy, who was behind me, while we're walking to a shadow figure that we just saw split second before he says this, he stops in his tracks, and I kind of stop and look at him, and he's looking around, and he said, "Who touched me? Who pulled me?" And I said, "What happened?" Somebody had actually grabbed the back of his shirt and stopped him and pulled him back a little bit.
Oh, creepy.
Right, very interesting. Nothing negative, nothing aggressive or anything, just kind of a stop and wait. You know, maybe you're getting too close to my friend over there, or no, I just walked behind you, you're missing me, kind of thing, you know. We also found a bare footprint in this room, and this dust in this room is incredible. I mean, it's just layered on top of layers on top of layers. I mean, it's thick, and it's pitch dark in this place. There's no electricity. There's glass on the ground. There's dirt on the ground. There's even areas of asbestos. So you would not be walking barefoot. I don't care who you are. You would not be walking barefoot. And this little footprint was smaller than my feet. So I could only assume it was a child. And I put my hand down on the ground and lifted up, and I could not get my handprint to go into the dust like that.
Wow.
So I started
Chris
really digging in there.
Chris mentioned that, as well as there's a little girl that's inside that building that goes all over the place.
That's correct. Yep, that's one of the stories, is there's a little girl that roams the hallways and roams the abandoned areas as well.
Does it roam the apartments above?
Apparently it does. From what we're hearing from people that used to live there and that people who still do live there, they have seen a little girl walking the hallways. Now, thankfully, every story we hear are not negative or aggressive type spirits. It may even be residual, where it just happens over and you know, in a loop.
Right. So, in other words, it's not What do they call the difference between? I don't remember what they call that. It's
well, I would say it's not a negative entity.
No, what I mean is that it's not a ghost who is active per se, like the ghosts I have here, the old men that mm-hmm. used to live here, and they actually do stuff. This is a girl that just walks the same path over and over and over, and it's like an imprint.
Right. I believe that the young girl may be a residual, a loop. I believe the piano playing is the same thing. But there are other things that interact with you, active hauntings, because they do answer an EVP. We do get EMF readings off of them. We do get tapped, touched. They watch you. You can see them watching you. Actually, I'm known as the big prankster in Haunted Toledo. I don't even know how they allow me to still be there because I goof off so much.
You gotta have
but,
fun.
But, yeah, one of the pranks that I played, and of course I always focus on Tillman because he's the skeptic, and I need to give him a scare. So on the Commodore Perry, the manager that was with us was very excited about my prank and helped me find some props. And we found a broomstick and a mannequin's head, and we propped it on there, and then we put a shirt over it. And we waited for a good 10 minutes in this really dark room for Tillman to walk through, and I kind of poked the mannequin's head out of the doorway until he noticed it. And I had it high up so it wouldn't be a normal person. He would have to take notice and say, what in the world can that be, you know? So
yeah.
I'm turning it on the broomstick so it looks like its neck is turning and looking at him. And I can hear him freaking out saying, what is that? What is that? And as he gets closer to investigate it, I had somebody jump out from behind this pillar like they were going to grab him. And he just shrieked. It was one of the best things that has ever happened.
Oh, I bet he wished it didn't get aired online.
Oh, man. It was brilliant.
That's awesome.
Yeah, but he kind of expects something like that. I have to change it up. Some places I don't do any pranks. Like Delaney's, we did Delaney's. I didn't do any prank there. So he's on guard, but he doesn't know when it's going to happen.
Right.
But Commodore, I played a few of them on him. I hid Nicole, one of our amazing investigators. I hid her in this, I don't know, like 40-year-old fridge in this kitchen. And I kind of cracked the door so it was just a little bit open. And I told her I'm going to ask her questions like she's a spirit and for her to knock on the fridge door inside.
Yeah.
So I get on my walkie and I say, Tillman and Ryan, can you come out here? There's some weird activity going on in the kitchen. And they come running. They're all excited. And I'm trying to keep it together. I can't even face them while I'm asking questions because I'm trying not to laugh. And I pull myself together and I say, you know, stuff like, if you're a female, please knock once. And they hear the knock.
Right.
And Tillman immediately says, no way. You know, and he's trying to find it. And then I say something like, if you've been here for a very long time, knock once. And there's a knock. And Tillman's following this noise. He gets up to the fridge, and Nicole jumps out. I mean, it was beautiful.
Freaking cool.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I'm the troublemaker.
Yeah, well, you know, it's good to have a troublemaker like that, though, too. Because it helps you keep alert. And you've got somebody like you, that, you know, will do the prank, but when something legit's going on, it's like, it makes it even more freaky.
Right.
You know?
And if something freaky's going on, they usually send Nicole and me together. Nicole is pretty sensitive. Anytime I need to confirm an energy or something, I call Nicole over and she can, you know, confirm and say, yes, I feel it too. And we walk around trying to figure out how to almost make it calm down and stop pacing, because sometimes they pace and try to get away from you.
Yeah.
And I was actually a youth pastor for a long time. And I personally had gone on many, many, many exorcisms. Some, I would say most were not legit. I think it was more mental illness problems, things like that. But some of them were absolute, definite, real exorcisms that we were performing. So when I go in, I have this black pack on my leg. And I have my flashlights in there, of course. But what I also have in there is holy water. I have some sage. And I have black salt and white sea salt. And
awesome.
I studied doing Bible college, taking demonology for a while. I've done a lot of researches in different cultures and religions. So whenever something feels like a negative or something, they call me in and ask what I might be sensing. Like the bone house. The bone house.
Right. I just wanted to get to that. Hang on. We're going to talk about the bone house for a second because I think I saw you on TV.
Yes. Yes, you did. I got a message from somebody that was a friend of the homeowner saying that they had some really weird stuff happening and they found a bunch of bones and would Haunted Toledo come in and investigate. And I said, well, I'll be happy to speak to the homeowner and see what's going on because usually we just don't do residents. You know, we do establishments. We do businesses. We do historical sites. But this became very intriguing. So I showed up to give kind of like an assessment what I think is going on. And the news crew was there. So I'm walking through, and the amount of bones that were in this house was frightening. It wasn't just a couple here and there. I'm talking about every wall, underneath every floorboard, we found bones. And it wasn't just like chicken bones or something. They had goat bones. They had dog bones.
And do you think there were human bones? Do you think there were human bones?
I hope not. I can't be certain. Some of these bones are really, really large. It's either a very large dog or it's possibly human. I can't be certain on that.
Yeah,
I am certain that it's Santeria, though.
I agree 100% about the Santeria side of it. And being in that neighborhood where that house is, it would have been pure Santeria that was used. It would have been old school Santeria at the same time because of the time period. And
right.
At the new stuff that they do today. Chris said something about them being very big bones, but he also said the mortician said this, but at the same time,
well,
they only took a handful. They took a handful of bones and said, okay, well, we're going to classify it all this way, which is so typical.
Right.
What they would do.
Arizona
doesn't
even
use
go upstairs.
Human sacrifice. They didn't even go upstairs. But
They stepped inside the front room, and the officers took the bones from the front room, and did not go upstairs, did not look at the other floorboards or the walls, did not see the personal items that were hidden with these bones, like perfume bottles, a very beautiful old woman's hairbrush, letters, very interesting letters, and these were so old and so brittle they fell apart in your hands. One was completely in Spanish, and the other one was very dark and very scary. It was like a scorned lover that was upset at this woman for her being in love with somebody else, but it seemed like the woman he was in love with wasn't aware that he had feelings for her. It was very interesting.
Classic love story.
Right. Classic love story in a very sick sci-fi movie kind of thing.
Now, the other thing that interests me is that when I was young and when I was into the occult, but not into the occult, you know, I was a wannabe type of deal, but I would walk past the Green Lantern, and I would always look at the Green Lantern like there was something wrong with it. But what was actually going on was the house behind it.
Two houses behind. There's the lantern, then there's another house that's also abandoned, and then the next house on the corner would be the one.
That's what I thought. I thought it was the house on the corner. It's blue. It's the blue house.
It's white with, I think, blue shutters.
Okay. Yeah, because I had the opportunity to drive past it once, I think it was last week, knowing exactly where it was, and it was kind of freaky.
Yeah. Well, the inside, it has so much potential. I mean, it has like 10-foot ceilings. You can imagine it being this incredible home. I mean, right now it's, you know, being renovated and torn apart, but Scott, the owner, really has a good eye on homes. I mean, and the interesting thing is, oh my goodness, that brings me to the interesting thing. When he first purchased this place for like $1,000 on auction, he started getting letters in that mailbox from a man that was insisting on going up in the attic because there was something he has up there that belonged to him, that he knew who used to live there. Now, upon further research, it's not that this man knew who used to live there. He was married to the daughter of the woman that died there.
So he wanted to go up there and get the letters and so on and so forth. That's what he wanted
only
to do.
Only possible explanation, because there was nothing in this home. Nothing.
But the thing that's past that is the fact that if he knew where this stuff was, then he knew about the bones, and nobody has questioned him.
Right. If anything, if those letters, I don't believe that those letters were from him.
Right.
But
I'm
think that he continued the Santeria as the family did, because this house was in the family for generations.
Yeah. I think that somebody needs to really talk to him about it. And the police want to blow this off because it's one more case that they don't want to be involved in. But Santeria doesn't usually involve human sacrifice.
Correct.
So with that being said, it's probably not human bones. Or maybe we had a serial killer there at the same time and nobody knew about it. So somebody who can do the research needs to do the research and figure this out. Chris mm-hmm. said something about how there used to be a butcher. I don't remember a butcher being around there, but Chris said something about there being a butcher. But my question is why would a butcher take his bones over to this house other than, you know, Santeria uses chicken blood and they use chicken feet to scry their pages that they're going to do their spell work on. That's done in
right.
Santeria. So
and
that
goats.
Explains the chicken bones. They use goats mm-hmm. for sacrifice. That's what the goats
right.
were for. The goats were for sacrifice.
Now, we can go as far as saying that these things were sacrificed, possibly because this woman that died there, she did have a very long illness, and maybe they were trying to work some protection spell. I mean, that is possible. But it could also be because of these strange letters.
Well,
this
could,
man working a spell on a woman who he was in love with, but she
actually
didn't feel the same.
It would be more they believed that someone had put spells on this old woman, and that's why the sacrifice with the goats.
Right,
they
like
were
a protection
used doing,
spell.
Doing the spell work to go against and try to hurt the other people that were and stop the spell from hurting the lady at the same time. Because it's
could
not
very well be.
Santeria is just like all other magic. It's not all white light stuff like everybody wants to project on it today. It is you do what you need to do, and that is the realism of it. It's not that Wicca wasn't even around back then, and people don't Wicca. You know, people don't want to realize the fact because Wiccans. Our Wiccans. I'm dying. I'll piss somebody off. I gotta shut up. You know.
Well, I have a lot of Wiccan friends. I enjoy a lot of what they do. But just like Christians or Judaism, you have the good white areas, and then you have the darker areas. And that's true with any type of religion that you're going to go to. You're going to have the people that are doing things for the good, and you're going to have people that are doing things for the bad.
It's human nature. It's okay, right. I am going to be, if I'm a good person, and okay, I'm in the occult, but I'm a good person, that's, I'm not going to do anything to hurt people just because I can do that. But somebody hurts, like, for example, my granddaughter, I'm going to drop a house on them, just like anybody else would do the very same thing. And, it, mm-hmm. okay, it's my karma, and I have to deal with it, but I understand that. And I'm just making an example of the difference between what's realistic and what people say and what they claim.
Right.
You know, and back in the day, things were even more like that. Because if she did Santeria, that means she probably did tarot, and she did palm reading and crystal ball work and so on. And that was her
living.
Well,
I always try to explain Santeria as a worship of the saints, but also both the angelic spiritual end and the demonic devil end.
Santeria is a cross.
It's kind of like a mixture between Catholicism and hoodoo and voodoo.
That's just what I was going to say. Hoodoo is the original religion, and voodoo is the cross between Catholicism and hoodoo. And Santeria, on the other end, is a cross between Mexican witchcraft and Catholicism. Or I can never say that word right. So you mix the two together, and you've got something that's morphed into something that, for someone that knows what they're doing, you really don't want to mess with them, because they get their stuff from all sides.
Oh, yeah.
You know, definitely. But again, it all depends. Oh, I don't know what this woman was. I don't know how she was. I don't know if she was a nice person. I don't know if she was, a bad person. I don't know anything about this lady. I've never been able to pick up anything about this lady.
I haven't either. Even when we were investigating, the first night, I felt energy, but it wasn't strong. And I kept telling Tillman, there's something there. I'm promising you there's something there. And he said, no, there's nothing in here. Well, I started getting, I'd say, a bit annoyed that this spirit was, or whatever it was remaining quiet the whole night. So I decided to go in and start blessing the bones, because I knew that this was Santeria. This was used as a ritual, and I knew I'd get a reaction if I start blessing it. So I'm in there, and I have a camera guy with me, and I'm actually on Facebook Live at the time, and I'm blessing them. And every time that holy water and that sage water hit the bone, there's a growl.
I believe
it. Okay, and that's picking up on the speakers. That's not something that just is imagined. This actually came through. And people on Facebook Live even said, what was that? You know? And at one point I stopped because something growled words at me and I couldn't understand what the words were. But it was interesting to me. So after a few blessings, all the energy stopped. It left. You know, once you start blessing it, they kind of run.
Right.
And it kept racking in my head over and over that there's something there, there's something there. It's really coming after this family that's trying to renovate this place. So then I get a text from the owner's wife that says, look, we've been too scared to go into that home. I had to run in with my daughter to grab something. And whatever is in there is seriously mad, and I'm scared. And I said, okay, we're going to come back in. You know, I know there's something there. I can feel it. And Tillman's kind of agitated. He's all, you know, Shelton, I can't believe you're doing this. There's nothing there. So we get there, and I said, look, I'm going to trigger it. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to play Santeria music in that attic for a couple minutes, which I did, and then we turned it off and let the homeowners go up there by themselves. And they were very brave. They did a fantastic job talking to it and telling it, you know, come on, you want to scare us? Why don't you show them, you know, that you're real? So that night was one of the most active nights Haunted Toledo has had. We had voices coming through. We had three flashlights down, and we were able to ask it to light up a specific one each time. They kept touching the REM pod. Well, I kind of threatened it a little bit. I said if it didn't touch the REM pod, I was going to start blasting the attic again. So it did. And anytime it seemed like it was quiet and not being active for us, I said it again. I'm going to start blessing your ritual so you don't start touching that REM pod, letting us know you're here. And then it would, right on command. And at one point, we were upstairs communicating with something. And I'm going to say something because I don't believe it was a spirit. And as we were leaving to let the next group come up and we were going to take a break, a board flew across the room and landed in front of us trying to stop us from leaving.
Oh,
and
damn.
We caught it on tape.
Wow. This is what I, as you're talking, this is what I'm getting. I'm getting that, you know, a lot of the animals and whatever else is there is permanently trapped there by a permanent circle. You know how you're aware, having Wiccan friends, how we make our circles.
Right.
You can make them so they're permanent. So, and that is what's keeping them there. And that needs to be, it needs to be addressed in that fashion and torn down. And either you can do it from a distance, or you can do it, just go there and do it. You can do it either way. But mm-hmm. that needs to be taken care of so that everything is released and it can move on.
Well, that night I did a lot of blessings, a lot of sage, I sprinkled salt. The activity went almost completely gone. It was very weak. And about 2 weeks later, we came in again, this time bringing a deacon with us. And we came in and we could feel it there. It wasn't as strong as it was before. It was very weak. It was very upset.
Yeah.
And started blessing the home again with the holy water and everything and telling it to leave and that it was not welcome there any longer. And it has not been felt there since then.
Awesome.
We actually just all, we felt so different. The entire house kind of lit up. Even though there's no electricity in there, it was so much lighter in there. It was so much like a normal house finally. You know?
Awesome.
It was a big difference.
That's good. That's great. That's awesome, man. Have you been in Tony Packos? Everybody remembers Tony Packos from MASH.
Yes.
Yeah, you've been there.
Haunted Toledo, Christopher Tillman has investigated Tony Packos.
And I wasn't aware that, and everybody I've ever talked to always says nobody died there. So what happened?
Now, see, this was before I came into the group, so I'm not too educated on the history of that building just yet.
Okay.
But, you know, what I find when it comes to buildings, it doesn't always mean that somebody died there. Somebody could have died on the street in front of there.
Right.
Somebody could have died on that land plot way
before
that building was
built.
What
about the guy that drove his truck into the front of the building? He died there. I think he died there.
But I think that was more recent.
Right.
I think their stories of hauntings have gone before even that happened.
Okay, I'm totally unaware of... I've never picked anything up. I've been in Tony Packles, and it always felt decent to me. So,
But, you know, that doesn't mean that it's not there. Sometimes we can go into a place that we know is haunted, and we won't get anything because sometimes the way hauntings, they're so funny. Sometimes it's a 10-second clip of something, you know, a 10-second of a move a chair or something, maybe once a month or once every few months. And it just depends on what they want to do.
Depends, you know, on the mood.
Right,
yeah.
It really does, because when I talk about spirits, I talk about them as living people almost. Like, you have your good-natured people that are wonderful and positive. And then you have your bad-natured people that are just dark and negative and evil. And that's the same way that once you pass away, that your spirit doesn't change. You're the same type of creature. You're the same type of flavor.
That's what I tell people all the time.
You know, people always wonder why something is negative, but it could still be a human spirit and not an evil entity. And there's just a big, big difference. I mean, you can taste, smell, and feel the difference between a negative, mean person and a dark entity. Now, granted, I've never come across a human spirit that was like a murderer or somebody. So maybe that type of spirit is a lot closer to a demonic entity. And I don't know the difference between those two yet. But I have come across negative, angry, sad spirits. I've come across happy, wonderful spirits. And I've come across demonic entities. And there are just big differences between
them. I have met things that would make demons look like an ADD child that's misbehaving. Mm. There's a lot worse out there.
Well, yes, because demons actually come in levels. You have your small little pawns, and it goes up in tiers. I mean, they have strengths to them. It's almost like a military rank.
Okay, well, we will save that for a little bit of a discussion after we're done with the show. Oh, man. All
but
right.
I've yet to find a demon that can, you know, ignore a blessing or the Seal of Solomon or something like that.
That's the difference between messing with a demon and dealing with a demon and dealing with something else, because something else doesn't even pay attention to that.
Mm. Well, I hope I don't cross that path then.
Well, I hope you don't either, honestly. Anyhow, it's been about an hour. Do you want to continue with this, or do you have things to do?
Well, actually, I was going to talk to you about the toy drive that we're doing for the ProMedica children at Toledo Hospital.
Oh, yes, yes, okay. All right, I'll switch gears here. All right, so there's one more thing that you wanted to talk to me about, and that has to do with toy drive. And so we can talk about that, and then we can give our links. We can tell people how to find the links for the petition and all that kind of happy stuff before you leave.
Wonderful.
So go for it.
Well, Haunted Toledo is doing a toy drive for the ProMedica Toledo Children's Hospital. As I've said earlier in the show, that I have been reading for hospitals for a long time, and this is one of the hospitals that I read for. And we are trying to do something wonderful for the children because, you know, being in the hospital during Christmas is just awful, not just for the child, but for the entire family and the siblings of these children. So we're trying to collect new and unwrapped gifts to deliver on December 15th. And we're really hoping that the community responds and helps us put some smiles on children that really need it the most.
That's very cool.
You can get information on that from Haunted Toledo's Facebook page. There are several drop-offs. Banner Mattress is one of the drop-offs.
Okay.
And Trot and Charlie's Bar is on Detroit Avenue. That's another drop-off. There's just a couple different places, and it's just these big cardboard boxes. Just run in, throw in a couple toys, give a blessing to a kid that really needs it and their family.
I have to give kudos to you guys. You're so busy, so active. You've got your hands into so many different things, and I think that's really great.
Community matters to us. That's why we're called Haunted Toledo. I mean, Toledo matters. Toledo, you know, we really want to not just preserve history in Toledo, we really want to help the community. We do. I mean, I volunteer in schools. I help children that are on special education IEPs,
right.
Read tests to them. We each do different things. We are handing out frozen turkeys pretty soon with a church before
Oh, cool.
Thanksgiving. We like to help the community. This is our community, and we are going to make it great.
That's freaking awesome. I was not even aware of some of the stuff that you're talking about here. So how do we get back to that position? How do we find a petition again? Do we go to your Facebook page, Haunted Toledo Facebook page, or your page?
And, correct.
Okay.
And we really need some support on that. And I'm also going to be standing in different locations in Toledo personally picking up signatures from people. I'll Facebook Live during those times. I'll announce where I'm going before I go.
Right.
Would love to come out and meet people. Listen, Saturday night, I'm going out all over Toledo to meet the fans, make some new fans, make some friends. I'm going to be doing, I'm going to call it Haunted Toledo Selfies. Take some pictures of the faces of the community with me. I'm a people person. We want to reach out and meet everybody.
Very awesome. Well, we are about out of time then, and thank you, Sarah, so much for being on the show. And I do want to have you back, just like I want Chris
thank
back
you
at
so
some
much.
Time. And
but I'm clearly better.
Well. I'm not going to pick favorites here.
If he'll I pick just talk favorites, about ghost boobs.
Yeah. Ghost boobs, is that what you said?
Yeah, that's what his topic.
or your tiny hands, yes.
Right, and they're not tidy, I promise. He just makes fun of me because I'm 5'1 and a half.
So what's your favorite radio station?
Well, yours, of course.
Black Swamp Radio.
Black Swamp Radio.
There you go. All right. You have a good one, and I'll see you.
Thank
bye.
You. You too. Da, 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 da. Magic finds us kicking up the dust along the road. Silence travels farther than a story often told. Vagabond I've been, and vagabond I'll always be. Running down the devil at every crossroads that I see. I never thought to be called back to a home that I outgrew. But the summer's gone, the call is strong, and there's something I must do. Thought I knew all of the stories that a southern girl could know. But there's a dream of Mississippi that I never tell a soul. With his arms outstretched to me when I pass by. Some days I wish my heart were dead, too tired to even cry. When missing him is all I do, the days all pass me by. Like these dreams of Mississippi and these ghosts who cannot lie. Oh, this ring rests on my finger like a baby on a wall. And whispers gather round me, come to dance when darkness falls. Everything I see adds up to say the tale is told. But back into his arms is really not that far to fall. There is moonlight on the river where I never thought I'd go. There's a dream of Mississippi that I never tell a soul. Distance brings us closer now than ever I supposed. Ooh, so I'm going where the sunshine shimmers right through summer's end, where the heat will lay you out before the harvest comes to mend. The world I thought was done with me has called me back again with these dreams of Mississippi. And this ghost who calls me friend. There is moonlight on the river where I never thought I'd go. There's a dream of Mississippi.